proceed?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. Yeah, give thanks. It's an honor to be here at Sankofa. This is like a homecoming, you know. I haven't had the opportunity to do too many public events in D.C. Really, I would say the last 10 or 12 years, you know. But I am a native Washingtonian, four generations. My great-grandfather moved up from North Carolina right here to 745 Girard Street, raised my grandmother, who then moved to 1218 Girard, raised my mom at 1218. And yeah, so, you know, my great-grandfather actually helped found Howard School of Theology. My mother's father was an oral surgeon who was very instrumental in founding Howard School of Dentistry. And so, you know, when I lived in D.C., I lived right across the street in that. For a couple of years, I lived in the apartment across from the bank, or next to the bank. And I worked that back in the day with the House of Knowledge on Harvard, you know, with Keyway Bay. Mm-hmm. You know, that was like where I really got rooted in the culture. You know, I went to Howard, full scholarship, and studied in the School of Communications. Had the honor of having Haile Garima as a professor. You know, script writing class. You know, very challenging, but very rewarding. And so, you know, but I was of the generation that came up with that when that war with drugs was real intense in D.C. And a lot of my generation, it's like, where are we? We're everywhere but here, you know? I'm not alone. It's like, when I go to, like, the areas where I grew up and live, very different.
Yeah.
And a lot of the families that I was connected with, uprooted, you know? And our generation, the elders might still be there, you know, but our generation is everywhere but here, you know. So it feels good to be here.
Yes,
you know, it's been, you know, like helped me reconnect with certain ancestral forces and ancestral awareness that I'm thankful, you know. So, as the sister said, I work with crystals and sacred stones. Now, how I got on this path, don't ask me, you know. But it all did start here, you know. There was an elder named Jertha Love, okay, ran a, metaphysical church here in the city.
Sure,
he was Dick Gregory's pastor. And him and Keyway Bay were very close. I was Keyway Bay's, like, you know, I carried his bags and worked with him, you know. And he had, Jertha Love was doing a spiritual retreat out in Moon Ridge, Maryland. And they were fasting for 3 days, right? Doing different workshops and things. And Bay was going to cater the break fast, the final event, which was going to be a meal, right? So I helped prep that and went out there with him, right? So I looked at it as an opportunity to be out in the woods.
Exactly.
Because we was out of that city, right? And we had set up the food. I was out in the woods, and they were like, yeah, Ross, there's one last workshop. It's on crystals. You need to come in and be a part of it. And I did not want to be inside, so I was resisting it, you know? But, you know, the elder was like, come in here, you know? So I sat in there, but I'm telling y'all this because I was not paying attention. I was on some old, you know, I didn't want to be there. You know when you're somewhere and you don't really want to be there, you're not fully present? That's the state of mind I was in. You know, so I was half listening, you know. And, but then when they were sealing up, right, Jertha Love's wife had everyone circle up and she said a prayer. She said, she prayed that the mineral nation came into everyone's life, right? And again, I didn't really think too much of it. I was supportive of her because y'all might know Brother Artis. Brother Artis, he's down in Virginia now. He used to run the body ecology truck up here. So he was the one facilitating. So I wanted to support the brother. So I did buy a crystal and a book that he was selling. But again, I really wasn't thinking about no crystals, right? Then about 6 months later, right? I don't know what happened, but I caught like this crystal mania. That's all I can say. I caught a crystal mania where, you know, all I wanted to do was buy crystals. And like, you know, crystals was just on my mind. Crystals, 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 right? So by this time, me and my Empress, we now we married. We got a newborn on this set. Right? And, you know, I just had little hustles here and there right out of college, but I didn't have no firm foundation. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And, but it'd be a thing like if I went to, there was this co-op, right? Wifey would send me out. I'd have like $40 in my pocket. She'd be like, get some milk, get some bread, get some, you know, this, that, right? Rice milk, you know. So, don't let me see a crystal. Oh. Right? I'd come back with like $15 of groceries and $25 crystal. You know? And so it was creating problems. It was creating stress in my relationship and my family. Right? And the tipping point. It was like I seen this crystal. It was actually the crystal that ended up being on the cover of the first edition of the book, right? I seen this crystal. I was like, I'm going to resist. I'm not going to buy it because I don't want to cause no drama, right? So this thing was coming in my dreams, right? Like 2-3 weeks. Wow. This thing just kept.
And you let him go.
Like, coming in my heavens, coming in my mind, right? So I was like, shh. I did some work. It was like, bam, I came into like a couple $100. You know, it wasn't just like 40 or 50 in my pocket. I had a couple $100. So I was like, I'm going to get it. You know? Wifey can't trip too hard, right? But she did. When I came in with that crystal, what? Judgment. So I made a decision at that point. It's like, I'm gonna start selling crystals. I've always had a, like when you say, like an entrepreneur, hustle,
spirit.
Mentality, spirit, you know? I was like, I'm gonna just start selling the crystals, you know? So that's what I started doing. I, you know, have a little table, different little spread of crystals, right? And because the thinking was, whatever I sold, I make the money from the crystals, then that'll like feed my habit, right? You know? So it was an African Liberation Day, right at Meridian Hill Park. I had my table set up, and this elder came up to my table, and he looked at it. He looked up at me. He said, what does this have to do with African liberation?
Wow.
I ain't had nothing to say. Yeah. I ain't had nothing to say because I ain't know nothing. I told you, this thing was like something coming from within. Mm-hmm. And I'm sharing this because obedience is its own reward.
Ooh.
Okay? Because after Elder hit me with that, it was like, I gotta be able to answer that. So I started making these. This is 1990. Okay? Started making these like laminated sheets to have on my table. Crystals in the Bible. Crystals in Kemen. Crystals in melanin. You know? And so the more I researched, the more I would, you know, I'd make a laminate. You know? So then it came like, at one point I had maybe 12, 13 laminates, right? This is 1992 now. And this next elder, I'm at an event, the next elder comes up and pulls up a chair. And he sat down and read every laminate, one after the other, right? And when he finished, he said, you need to write a book. I said, you know what? I am. And so from there, it was 8 years. It was an 8-year project because my family was growing, you know? And by the time I published, I probably had 3-4 youth. And I felt like I needed to self-publish. I submitted it to like Red Sea Press, a couple of other, you know, like when you say African
publishers,
right? But, you know, at this time, I had not only nobody knew about black crystals in our community. It was like, what? You on some new age? You following Shirley MacLaine? And, you know, I had to create my market everywhere I went, you know? Like, yeah, that's, you know, I've used those laminates, you know? But by 2008, the second edition was coming out, right? We had a next generation on the set that just had a natural affinity and a natural gravitation to the crystals, you know? So, yeah, I give thanks. This is kind of where I've grown it. You know, being committed, that's why I say obedience is his own reward. Because if I didn't follow that spirit that Jertha Love's wife brought into mind with that prayer, I wouldn't be standing in front of y'all today. You know, and it ain't been an easy journey, but it's definitely been rewarding, you know. And it's afforded me to have opportunities like this where I can travel, meet, build community with different ones, and help and heal and serve, you know? So I'm very thankful, you know? And since I was here in D.C., I felt like I had to kind of, you know, tell the story, you know? Because it all happened right around here, truth be told. This is the second edition. Cover first edition is on the back, you know, so you can see that crystal, that set it all in motion too, you know? And so, Rocks of Ages is a different type of book. If you're looking for an A to Z encyclopedia of crystals, it's going to disappoint you. You know, like A for Aventurine, B for Burl, C for Crystal Cola, you know? Now, really what this book is, the intention and the design of this book is to awaken the Earth Keeper inside of you, okay? Because there was never a time we were not, we're eternal beings. Past, present, future. And one of our infinite incarnations, we were earth keepers. We were ones that dealt with the mineral nation and dealt with crystals. So it's in our DNA. Especially if you are of the bloodline of Kush, Kemet, Israel. You know? Because when we were at our cultural heights, crystals was the central part of our spiritual technologies, you know? So it's in our DNA. So when we read how our ancestors used crystals, that's been chronicled like in the book of Coming Forth by Day, that has several chapters that allude to crystals, right? One being the chapter called A Buckle of Carnelian. It says Carnelian is the blood of all Set, and who wears this is going to have, you know, her protection and her covenant with you. Paraphrasing, you know, with the following rubric that tells the priest how to award someone that buckle of Carnelian, you know, by dipping it in uncle water of uncle flowers, you know, and saying certain hey cool words of power over it, you know. So when we read these things and get these visions back in our minds, back in our heavens, it awakens something that's inside of us, you know. So you got a lot of that in there, a lot of Kush, Kemet, Dogon, Zulu, indigenous use of crystals and sex stuff. But then we also deal with the science of the chemistry of humanity. Okay? That melanin beings, we got a different biochemistry, we got a different alchemical.